We have three speakers in this session. Our first speaker is Yıldız Kahveci. She has completed her primary school education in Çorlu. After she graduated successfully from Maden High School, she started her bachelor's studies in the Department of American Culture and Literature at Ege University. In her sixth semester, she went to Austria as an Erasmus student. Being highly interested in the field of literature, she intends to continue her studies in a master's degree in American Studies program in Europe. As a main field of study, she is concerned in women's studies and aims to assume a feminist point of view in her own women's studies. We will listen to her paper titled Identity and Mother, Father, Dichotomy in Toni Morrison's Below Than Death. Now I'd like to leave the speech to her.
Thank you. Welcome everyone, and I thank you to for our session. I will focus on mother-father dichotomy in Love and Jazz in terms of identity. Though widely known as murder narratives, Toni Morrison's two novels, Love and Jazz, as the former one is concerned with the felonious murder of a child by her own mother, the subsequent rather gives voice to a slaughter carried out by a man of his young lover, indeed going in detail, are more of two stories of lost souls who cannot place themselves anywhere owing to their common ground of being brought up without mother care. Morrison argues that self-love depends upon the self's first being loved by another self. Before the child can love herself, she must experience herself being loved and learn that she is indeed valuable and deserving of affection. So, Morrison widely deals with either slave or ex-slave characters who love to receive any love primarily from their mother, which causes them to be in deep crisis of identity and difficulty of living harmoniously with the self and the human community and the past. Because of the indispensable burdens of the slavery, which out of many is the mandatory separation of mother and child. And due to the lack of this mandatory separation, they are far away from experiencing self-love. Hence, their suffering of lifelong unbelonging to anyone and the will of unification with the missing one can be considered as a consequence of all these and a reason of the character's quest of self through the novels. Moreover, Morrison confronts the reader with another character, Golden Grey, who is also in search of a lost parent, but instead of a mother, father this time. However, this separation, besides causing an inevitable loss of identity, causes hatred and a will of destroying his father accordingly himself. So, I intend widely to focus on the parental relations and to what extent they affect the characters mentioned above in the process of their identity constructions or, on the contrary, the loss of their identities. However, the main question is how the effect of lack of a mother affection and the lack of a father can differ on such a great extent, even though in both of the situations identity crisis is inevitable, the loss of a mother leads the character to a lifelong quest of this missing motherly affection. On the other hand, loss of a father leads to hatred and inward will of destruction and disgust. The topic of parental relations is widely referred to in both of the novels. Especially paternal care and its lack are in the core of both the Love and Jazz. Toni Morrison closely relates motherhood and slavery, and widely witnesses the indispensable negative outcomes of slavery over the mothers who were also daughters once. It is obvious that both of the novel's protagonists, Jotres, Violet, and Sete, suffer from lack of a mother and accordingly get mentally lost. Being abandoned by their mother, they get fractured inside their souls and their bodies get separated from their self. This creates an alienation which is only possible to heal with the putting back the long-gone mother for the affection of hers. As far as self, to displace the self, and locate the best of the self in another, the beloved. So it can be said that Joe and Sete displace the self and locate the best of the self on someone whom they substitute with their lost mothers. Joe locates himself on Dorcas, his girlfriend, and Sete on her daughter, beloved. Sete in beloved kills her own daughter in order to protect her from slavery. On the other hand, Joe in jest kills her, his girlfriend, because of a jealousy of her being with another man. However, both of the murders are based on the fear of losing the beloved. And both are the people whom the protagonists devoted their lives to. As Jones states, they locate the best of the self in the other beloved. Therefore, it can be said that the inclination of murder derives from the crisis of identity, because the protagonists substitute their self with the people they appreciate most. In addition to this, neither the characters in Beloved nor in Jest had the opportunity to experience mother care, as all of them were forced to grow up separately due to the rules of slavery. The black women are forced to leave their children and go to the fields under slavery. When we look to Beloved, we see a long, infected chain of women, all of whom lack mother care, and accordingly they long for mother care and provide it sufficiently for their own children. When Sete tries to explain to Beloved why she cut her throat, she's explaining an anger handed down through generations of mothers who could have no control over their children's lives, no voice in their upbringing. As this infectious disease goes on with the generations, its effects are also present in the successive generations. These are Sete, her mother, and her daughters. Here, Sete is in the center of the chain, because she is the one who receives insufficient care, and hence lay on insufficient care for her own daughters. As if all the other children of slaves, she did not have the opportunity to know her mother, having been forced to get separate in infancy. When Beloved asks Sete if her mother ever fixed her hair or not, Sete's answer summarizes everything perfectly. She says that she must have nursed me for 3 weeks. That's the way the others did. Then she went back in rest and I sat from another mother whose job it was. So to answer you, no, I reckon not. She never fixed my hair nor nothing. She didn't even sleep in the same cabin most nights, I remember. Too far from the lineup, I guess. One thing she did do, she picked me up and carried me behind the smokehouse. Back there, she opened up her dress front and lifted her breast and pointed under it. Right on her rib was a circle and a cross burnt right in the skin. She said, "This is your mom. This is..." And this she pointed. "I'm the only one got this mark now. The rest dead. If something happens to me and you can't tell me by my face, you can know me by this mark." Owing to the fact that she has never received any maternal care, she never knows how to show any. Thereby, even after the abolition of slavery, black women continue lacking mother care, as they were also daughters once and have never received any care. On the other hand, Joe kills his girlfriend he already likes herself. Dorcas is indeed a trap for him in search of his identity. She is what Joe has lost, the trace of something for which he must hunt. Actually, the fracture, which we mentioned before, is his lost parents in Joe's case. Especially his mother, Wild, is where he locates his lost being. He hunts all through his life to be claimed by her. Being successful, he finds new tracks. Being unsuccessful, he finds new tracks to follow, and the last of which is Dorcas. up because of the hard conditions of slavery and the depression of a heavy burden on her shoulders of taking her children up alone. She also did not have the mother who first loves the child and gives the child the last sense of self. This is why she got lost on the way of bringing up her children. These children, while missing a mother care and learning to love, they also miss to learn to be someone as well, because the self must be numb and loved, and in Morrison's words, honored and released. When we do not name or nurture our own selves, we lose, forget about, or put to sleep as violent does the person we are. So, both Seth and Violet missed the opportunity of learning how to love and to be loved, and accordingly how to love themselves. In adulthood, the necessity of searching themselves derives from these missing points of their childhood. Yet, firstly, they need to find their parents in order to build a self-identity. On the other hand, fatherhood seems to be less important in the process of one's identity construction. Contrary to the others, Golden Grey, who suffers from a crisis of identity, even though brought up by a mother, rises Patrick against his father, who is unable to show fatherly affection to him. Actually, he is a mulatto who was born from a white mother. He mostly suffers from being neither white nor black. As John states, his name indicates his in-betweenness. He is golden, not white, gray, not black. He feels from the moment he finds out that he is black tainted. He hates his black self, and this self-hatred means that he has to destroy its source, his father. Dichotomy appears at this point, and while lack of a mother makes the child hunter of a mother, as Joe is throughout the novel, how does lack of a father makes its way until self-destruction? In neither of the novels, any male character is given the role of a father. Even if there appear some male characters, they are associated with their children as if in Golden Grey's case. Nevertheless, Morrison does not totally separate mother from the child. Even though the opportunity of fulfilling mothering is not given to the black woman, she unifies mother and child in the same characters in her narratives. As it is narrated in Jazz, Joe longs to discover where he comes from so that he may at last know who he is. So in Joe's case, as in the others, the mother determines where they come from and who they are. And when they lost the one who they really are, they confront with a crisis of identity. On the other hand, Golden Grey, rather being a part of his father, hates to be a part of him and the idea of having been came from him. As if the other characters that are also missing a parent, Golden Grey starts his quest only to cut his bonds from his father if there is left any. All in all, it can be said that Morrison never placed fatherhood to the center of character's identity formation. As a matter of fact, she never puts together father and child as she does with the mother. It is understood from the narratives that fatherhood plays almost no importance in the construction of self-identity. Golden Grey is also in a loss of identity, even though he does not lack a mother care as the others do, but a father. He prefers to cut away this incomplete half of him, which he never sees incomplete, completable with his other part. On the other hand, there are the other characters like Joe, Violet, and Sette, who are inevitably in need of filling this gap which mothers obligatory create when they leave their children. So the dichotomy in Beloved and Just is that while mother is the inseparable part of the individual, father can be a redundancy, although either of their absence causes an identical crisis.
She has been studying in the Department of English Language and Literature at İstanbul University since 2007. She is a senior student. Her main interests are romantic poetry, postmodern short story, absurd drama, and Irish literature. She is strongly interested in writing short stories, and she has been writing since 10 years. In addition to this, she deeply likes reading horror tales, especially from Victorian era. Besides, she likes learning new languages and cultures, particularly of South American countries. She can speak advanced English and a little bit Spanish. She likes to get her master's degree on English literature after graduation and start her academic career. We will listen to her paper titled Goodness But Not Greatness, Women as an Underprivileged Member of Society, Unless by Kahveci. Now I'd like to give the speech to her.
And thank you all for having managed to come at this hour on the second day of the conference. As she states, my title is Goodness But Not Greatness, and I think you will understand what I'm talking about while I'm analyzing the novel, Unless, by Carol Shields. To begin with, having written in 2002, Unless is Carol Shields' last novel, and presumably the most striking one among her other novels, including the ones which won several awards, such as Pulitzer, Orange Prize for Fiction, etc. It's like she meant it to be a semi-biography and wanted to tell her own story as a woman too. But to all intents and purposes, this is a novel written by a woman about a woman writer. And then again, she also writes about a woman in this three-layered story. There are several subject matters, of course. But I want to focus on the major one. Woman as a secondary sex in the patriarchal society. Shields focuses on the universal truth, as Rita calls it, the protagonist, which is accepted by not only men but also women, and that is the inferiority of the female sex in the patriarchal society. Rita lives with her husband and two daughters in an exquisite suburb near Toronto, and she also has a daughter going to college, sharing the same apartment with her boyfriend, brilliant and keen junior. As they lead a perfectly calm life, all of a sudden they found out that Nora is missing. They do not hear from her for a few days, just before they are told that she's begging at the street corner in downtown Toronto. And everyone tries to figure out why she's doing something like this, because she is always considered as a young woman, content with her life. She sits there with a banner with written goodness on it in her lap. And Rita also experiences a delayed epiphany, which, let's say, as Nora adopts a new kind of life, Rita also experiences a delayed epiphany, which search and answer comes up for us. A woman can never be as great as men. We read this statement from Danielle Westerman first, whose memoirs are translated by Rita Winters. And Rita's early university years, she was a, let's say, mentor of Rita. She's a well-known French feminist writer from Rita's early university years, yet this relationship is also a quite problematic one. We read about lots of women in Unless, and they are all miserable in some way or another, because they are simply just women, and they are doomed to be the second one in society. Then again, we comprehend what the word goodness means as we keep on reading. Both Nora's and other women characters struggle just to exist in such a world which offers them nothing rather than a submissive role as opposed to their actual expectations. The incident which helps Nora to open her eyes to the real state of women is really a shocking one for a young woman like her, who is brought up in a comfort, free from problems, and loved intensively by her parents. She witnesses a woman in a veil burning herself intentionally in public. One day she goes out to buy a check to the supermarket, and when she is on her way out, she sees this oriental woman in flames and runs for help towards her at once. She tries to put out the flames without thinking for a single moment and grasps her with her both hands. One is holding the dishrag at the same time. This event makes Nora think of the possible reasons. Why would a woman want to burn herself in front of everyone? Her own purpose, especially. And she realizes it must be because she must not have any other options to express herself. This society makes her wish to burn herself. She erects now, I mean Nora. Because we did it, men and women together. Men because they put women in the position of the second race, leaving them always in the shadows on themselves. And women because they completed in men deeds and their patriarchal system. And the dish rag in her hand makes her realize what she's been doing to herself all this time. Here we see how smart Caracius is to put this object into the sea, not any other one. And let's say here we see, I believe that it's because a dish rag is something a woman needs to think of, whether it's necessary for a cause or not. It's not obviously nor a small, functions excellently as the digested story. Also, looking back in order to see the ultimate reason for her breakaway makes the point in this escape much more hitting. Like the fact that women set herself on fire as a self-expression, Nora sitting at the corner of a street with a poster on her lap is also a strange way of expressing herself. Women have always been left without a choice by men throughout the ages. And they have given root to women's life on account of thinking them as weak, vulnerable, or even sometimes evil creatures. Evil creatures who may cause problems for men if they are allowed to act on their own. As we can see in Alexander Pope's saying, quote, most women have no characters at all, unquote. So they are meant to be shaped by men. This is what Nora stands against, and her poster is a token of her battle to this notion. That means she's experiencing an inner revival. It would not be enough for her to leave her school, boyfriend or family after being aware of this universal truth. Instead, she chooses to react in an expressive way. At the beginning of Unless, Rita says that her novel will be about those children. Of course, referring to Nora, her daughter. Yet she's unable to realize that her daughter has just come to life. I will analyze the reasons why Rita is unable to understand her daughter later. Nora, unlike her mother, is not late to stand up to this compulsory role attributed to women. And as soon as she sees the core of this distorted life, she's out there in the streets to make other women realize this. And get out of the shadow, or you can say wings of men. And how does she do that? Her poster, written goodness on it. Simple as that. She does not have to use a phallocentric language or bear herself out to gain recognition. Just presenting that object to the numb, careless, and ordinary people who are passing by at that spot every single second is fairly enough to practice her goal. And what does this poster mean? We get skeptical as we ruminate about it as well. A woman is never referred as great whatever she does, or accomplishes, or let's say ventures or anything. This quality is only attributed to men, and is also really easy to earn it for him, whereas a woman is not entitled for it by birth because of her biological sex. As far as I'm concerned, this statement sums up everything I've been discussing. It is being put forth by a true feminist like Westerman first. She appears as a spiritual daughter, or let's say a follower of Simone de Beauvoir, who belongs to the first wave of feminism. Rita is so influenced by Westerman that she also believes that Nora will know goodness, but never learn greatness. We see how Rita imitates Westerman, as she does in many aspects. She thinks that Nora has found out the big female secret of wanting but not getting. As for Westerman, quote, power which women seem to possess has to be seized, ignited and released, unquote. That means we are not again meant to be equal with men. As I put forth before, women have always been left without with a forfeit, even if they are allowed to make a choice. And Westerman is not to have a family. We can think this in both ways. First one is that in order to be a successful individual, you have to give up the idea of having a family or children or, let's say, a cozy home. And the second one is can be. She may does not even want to have any family at all. But when you think of it, it seems more likely that one wants to have a family accompanied with around him or her. Still, in Weston's case, it might be the normal one to avoid from having a family after she has gone through. Like she says, a woman has to seize her power, fight for it. And when she gains it, when she does gain it, she has to pay for the price. Because she's nature not supposed to have any. After all, this struggle and fighting, even if she does gain it, an inexplicable anger takes over her. Because consciously or subconsciously, she knows that she's obligated to fight for it at the first time. This anger reveals itself to the women who have the same sex with herself in some cases or less frequently to the men because she accepts the man as the other and feels good when she is admired by the other, or better yet, the patriarch who puts her into this position of anger, I mean. And if you try to manage both of them at the same time, it is inevitable to be in tumult and end up in misery like Rita. We are left no space to be happy without making tough decisions. We are doomed to let go one of our sides, either intellectual or domestic one. For a few decades, it's said that women can be both a mother and an intellectual at the same time. Yet, when it comes to prioritize those aspects, being an employee or an intellectual come along after the, in the list. Though she will not be able to do that until she gives up using male-oriented language and starts speaking Nora's body language, which is considered inferior as opposed to mind that is associated with men, of course. After these suggestions, it is acceptable that Nora is much more accomplished woman than both of these women, because she transcends the terms of society and tries to survive in and at the level of understanding. Virginia Woolf asserts that women, quote, women have served all these centuries as looking glasses, possessing the magic and delicious power of reflecting the figure of man at twice its natural size, unquote. She puts forward the issue so perfectly that we see how women are destined to serve to men one way or another. And Rita does serve to husbands, i.e. the society. Tom is a loving, decent husband, and a part of a few passages he does not appear much actively in the novel. And when he does, he brings the questions of the superiority of men over women. Being a doctor, he is the one who works outside and brings the money to home. And in the case of Rita, writing novels means cooking with your clothes. And you do not need to be outside for it, of course. You have to be indoors and just think that is considered as a passive job, unlike other professions. For this reason, Rita is already undermined by her surrounding, not verbally, but instinctively, because an artist is always treated as an outsider. And art, let's say this outsider's exile, is a boxroom. Even though she calls her spot at the used office desk a freedom chair, it is obvious that she is not completely free from the problems of her life. She seems to go on her life while Nora is out there somewhere packing in the streets. She tries to write a sequel for her first novel, My Time Is Up. But this novel will not only be about those children, as she says, but also building her own identity as an individual also. She will fail though, because she will try to put a mirror in front of her again, but this time not her husband, her daughter. That is why I keep saying that even her 20-year-old daughter is ahead of her when it comes to being an individual. She prides herself as pseudo daughter this time, her protagonist in the series, Alicia. She is depicted in such a way that it's like she is representing the goodness Westerman talks about. Yet, it's not satisfying enough for Rita to build an alternate daughter in the way she likes, deep down in her heart. Rita knows that she has a daughter, that she's been feeling broken for her sometime. If you think in terms of fiction, Rita has her writing as a distraction. I do not mean to say that writing fiction is something secondary, but for Rita, the characters she created is just pseudonyms, not real. Still, there's so much intervention for her, both from her new editor and her mentor, Daniel. They both function as obstacles for Rita in the text, let alone her helping her. But the question here is why she complicits with her obstacles, why she cannot just resist their interventions. The possible answer might be that she does not dare for it or have enough faith for herself. She soothes herself by saying that she is a well-known writer, has a decent husband and children because she has two other daughters apart from Nora, and has a beautiful house in the suburbs. She always thought that being happy is so simple. Even if you go through a series of misfortunes, and just after you can go back to being happy in a flash of a moment. Because she has never experienced an earth-shaking problem like this. When Virginia Woolf, those days, she got her legacy from her aunt and stopped working at a few jobs, which were open to women in those days, of course, babysitting, cooking, etc. She thought that no man in the world could make her independent ever again. So she believed that she bought her freedom. The things were different, of course, in those times. As for Rita, even though she is able to make her own money, she is not free from her university way problems, since she belongs to a third way of feminism. Maybe they do not have the independence fully from men. The issue of dependency takes place on different grounds in these days and ages. Rita still is the one who stays at home and takes care of her family's needs. Her profession as a writer comes secondary in her life, I mean. And the moment she loses her daughter, who stands for a mirror for her, Rita starts to pay close attention to her writing again, and vice versa. She forgets all about Alicia as soon as she gets back her daughter. However, Nora is not the young girl Rita seeks for when she wakes up at the hospital, but a grown-up woman who perceives the humankind's sufferings. In the second set, Simone de Beauvoir quotes a statement from Julian Benda's well-recognized bit, but called the Urea. Benda says, quote, "Man can think of himself without woman, but she cannot think of herself without man," unquote. Women have this tendency to define themselves through other gaze, other sexist gaze. And at the very beginning of the novel, Rita starts to introduce herself with her husband's qualities. He's being handsome, successful, doctor, and a faithful lover. This defining herself through her family does not end up there. After that, it comes her daughter's house and finally her writing. Man comes along and centralizes himself, becomes the absolute, the subject, whereas the woman becomes the other. It is not limited with just Rita and Nora. We see a serial women in Andes who end up desperate, miserable, unsatisfied neither with their lives nor themselves, and some of them are left alone, just as Rita's mother in law is. She also defines herself through her deceased husband, but this time she appears a more dependent woman than Rita herself. After he dies, her husband died, she gets more and more lonely, and we learn that she has nobody to talk to around her. At the very end of the novel, Rita's editor and Louis start talking, and we see how needy she is to talk and pour her heart out. It was more manageable for her when he was alive because she had something to associate herself with, her family, right, Rita? Substantially, we can foresee Rita's potential, and if she were to live in the way she did, I mean without the great incident of Nora. Louise is a miserable old woman who tries to establish a relationship with her granddaughters and Rita, though she fails because she is too inconspicuous to be noticed by them. And as soon as she gets the chance to connect with someone, she opens her deepest feelings and thoughts to him. She has never done something for herself until then. She has not much to tell, so she tells about her disappointments in others and especially in herself. She seems as the embodiment of the all-female troubles, sufferings, not taking being seriously by her father, husband, son. She has been used by them as a looking glass, reflecting them twice as their real size. And she has been content with being the faithful wife, devoted mother. In a way, she has been convinced to with the man and his repulsive deeds, i.e. the society, and rather than being with the corporation, with women. She repeated the same mistake of hers by choosing to be in solidarity with her real encounter. And for this reason, she has played what she suffered from, and unable to circle to stay in the same way as it was. One night, Rita and Tom go to a pub with their friends called Frontier Bar, and when she is gone for a ladies' room, she sees some words at the back of the toilet cover, with a piece of chalk and a rubber which women can use to write. Rita erases some of them to create space for herself and writes, "My heart is broken." This small scene talks for itself, actually. It seems as if women are left no other choice than expressing themselves in this small press room. Rita is able to face with her true feelings at this point when she does not have to use male-oriented language. They are so repressed that this toilet cabinet is the only place they can be who they really are. They try to find an alternative way of self-expressing, and they feel that their pains will gain recognition by other women when they see the reminiscence of these long, numbed pains. This yearning for expressing oneself leaves its essence all over the novel. Rita, for instance, goes to a writer's workshop for women, which she describes it as a lovely company, as if she wants to think of it as a home. Somewhere she can be at ease and chat with other women who deal with the same problems she does. There are seven of them who go through different paths of life with different problems. The leader of this group, Gwen, is deeply attached to her husband who wants her to remove her belly button with an operation just because he claims that it stings awfully. And how do you think she reacts? She does what her husband demands. She does remove with this surgery. We can all imagine what a sick thing to do. Yet after a couple of years, they go for divorce and Gwen is left with what she does. All these relationships, which look normal outside, carry some roots with themselves. And women are always the only ones who are supposed to undergo, whereas men do not have a slightest clue what's going on around them. They think that everything is how it is supposed to be. However, silence sometimes means more than it aims. There is this couple, both Rita and Tom know, Marius and Colin. While he thinks that everything is in the right track for all these years, one day she walks away from him, all of a sudden, and he cannot understand why. Then he finds her diaries in a desk drawer and realizes that misunderstanding separated them. After staying silent for all those years, and why would a woman leave such personal possessions behind? To hurt, of course. Susan Sontag claims that silence only functions with the breakthrough of it at the end. She says, quote, silence inescapably remains a form of speech, unquote. Marietta would manage what she wanted only when she let him know what she's been through and make him suffer as she did once. Then again, what is so heart-wrenching about it is that she comes back to him after she made her point. And that is what I meant when I talk about the dead ends of women. The point which makes Rita a bit different from other women around her is that she is aware of the true position of women in the society. But something stands in her way to grasp this truth to the full extent. I mean, she does not go to extreme to remove her navel like Gwen or transcend the superficial side of her life like Nora either. And being in such a limbo makes her so liberish, uncomfortable, and miserable. All those living characters in NLS indicates how included she is in this ancient problem as a consequence of her witnessing most of the different feminist generations. She saw too much and opened her eyes and mind without a fear to the ignored and repressed reality of women. And eventually, this made a perfect realist writer out of her. Unless it's not a book that we can read through in a linear time without stopping to think, it questions lots of notions which have survived in different societies with the same connotations. And these are that women have always been taken for granted regarding to their fathers, husbands, sons, and even men who are the lowest of the low because a woman can never be as great as men. She is expected to be content with the highest rate she can reach, and there is only goodness for her in this scenario, which has been written for thousands of years by the same author. And that's all I need to say for my paper.
Our last speaker is Betül. She was born in Ardahan in 1989. She is a senior Western language and literature student at Boğaziçi University. She is enthusiastic about attending academic conference on sharing ideas with friends. Previously, she has presented and chaired at a conference organized by interdisciplinary Oxford University. As a future goal, she intends to pursue an academic career in cultural studies. Her main interests are gender, queer theory, and early German cinema. Now I would like to do this speech to her.
Thank you. Thank you for your presence. Troilus and Criseyde is a tragic love story with Troilus in Instagram. I want to start my presentation with a brief summary of the plot for those who are unfamiliar with the story. Troilus is a well-read gentile man. He is closer to, though not equal to, his brother Hector in gallantry and martial skill. Criseyde is the widow daughter of the Sir Calchas, who courted treason and fled to Greece. As is the case in most love stories, Troilus is scornful of love and lovers in the beginning, but the moment he sees Criseyde, he falls in love with her, and his heart is tormented with this love. He falls on to death. Seeing his situation, Pandarus, Criseyde's uncle, mentions about his love to Criseyde. He motivates, threatens, and lastly persuades her to a discreet love relationship with this young knight. Troilus and Criseyde meet and consummate their love under the supervision of Pandarus. After some happy days, they have to separate. Being a seer, Calchas foresees the fall of Troy, and to save his daughter, he wants her to be exchanged with a war prisoner. So Criseyde is obliged to go by promising Troilus that she will return in 10 days. When she goes, however, she understands that she won't be able to return, and she yields to the flirtations of a Greek warrior there. Learning about her betrayal, Troilus gets killed in the battlefield and after killed many. Though the story is abundant with betrayals, Criseyde is notorious for forsaking Troilus in the literary tradition. With Chaucer's style, however, we meet a more realistic portrayal of her. Chaucer helps us to see what is to be a female under threat in every sense, in a male territory. His version of Criseyde is a practical woman who has to protect herself with her instincts. Generally, the plot goes around four male characters, namely Calchas, actor, Pandarus, and the female that is Criseyde. Calchas is not a proper father figure in terms of protection. He leaves his daughter sleeping in her bed and flees while Troy is under siege. Pandarus is her uncle. He has a homosocial, if not homoerotic, interest in Troilus. He threatens his niece with suicide if she rejects Troilus' love. He is also motivated about relationship that he said prevails him to think about her safety and honor rather than Troilus' needs and pleasures. Troilus is the male protagonist of the story, however, he is unable to act. He has a romantic vision of love. He is carried away with his fancies and feelings. He sees Criseyde on the pedestal and worships her with his elevated feelings, but he is far from the type of lover that Criseyde needs at that moment. For example, when they decide to exchange her with Prince Antenor, Hector soberly protests. He says, first, she is not a war prisoner. Who ordered this? What did they take us for? For my part, I would wish it were to be clear. It is not our practice to sell women here. In contrast to this, Troilus only demands for her going in an elevated and mannered way. He sits on the corner of his bed and starts crying. Hector is the only man that Criseyde trusts and looks upon. He is man of principles and honor. He has the masculine power that she needs for her safety. As it is wartime, safety has a primary role in Criseyde's decisions. Chaucer mentioned several times that she was frightened to death in the text throughout. When Pandarus informs Troilus' love, she tries to calculate outcomes. First, she thinks about his position. If she rejected his love, Troilus would turn bitter or he might kill himself. As the people of Troy hate her due to her father's presence, they would kill her if she caused such a thing. Other decisive element is Pandarus' manipulation and motivation. He says, please, Troilus is strong enough with you that you must help. He will die unless you do. He forces her to offer her beauty to Troilus. If in such beauty pity cannot try, then it is pity you should be alive. He even threatens her with killing himself. I will cut my throat, I with this very knife, and burst into tears. Under this situation, she has no option but to respond to his love. Three times she murmured with a scornful sigh, "Oh heaven, how unfortunate for me, for my name and my position."
condition lie in danger and my uncle's life maybe. But by God's guidance, I shall presently think how to keep my honor and to keep my uncle too. Then she says to me, seeing that she has softened Pandas word guarantees that she doesn't need to do other than engaging and smiling yet, etc. Chaucer spends great amount of time to emphasize her inner turmoil and insecurity. She quakes in hysteria, not knowing what to do. This emphasis on her feelings de-romanticize the quarter romance and the deconstructs. Chaucer's Criseyde is not a frivolous woman who betrays her beloved. Neither is she a romantic lover who will determine it despite the impending death. She has to be practical and realistic to make best out of this love relationship, and once she is able to get out of it, she does so. Criseyde is the one and only principal female character of this story, which draws attention of the reader. Her acts and deeds are juxtaposed with the four male characters. Chaucer positions her as the only realistic and practical character beside Hector. With his unique style, he makes it clear that she had to escape. Troilus is too self-interested to be a protected lover. Pandras is not interested in her passion. He only tries to use her as a means to be close to Troilus. When he sees Troilus is crying for Odysseus' departure, he says, besides all this, you must know as much as I do here. The town and round about is full of ladies, fairer than to all such. In my opinion, I will search them out and find me one or two. You need it though. Be happy that they are my own dear brother. If she is lost, we can procure another. Under these circumstances, Criseyde does best she can, but this helps Chaucer to make the value ethics of quarter romance by bringing this medium to my house. Thank you for listening.
I'm going to ask a few questions, but the first one is for Pınar and Kahveci's analysts. You talked about the dishrag scene that the Muslim woman burns herself, and you described it just as the as Kahveci says, ignition and really. So, do you think that ignition is also a kind of candle that is lit in that darkness? Because we say that in the frontier bar, those women write the things right on the door, and there's a kind of male sphere, and that's the female sphere, and they're just creating that binary positioning and right on itself. What do you think about this one?
Yes, of course you can say that, because this incident is not just a it's not just a thing that Nora all of a sudden finds out. There are some discomforts for her inside of her, and she goes home back, and she says to her mother, "Mother, I'm not happy. I'm not happy with my life. I'm not content with my life." And she hugs her from her belly, and it's like she seems like going back to her womb again. We can get that if we analyze it closely. There is some discomfort with her. And this incident just only functions in the novel is a kind of a let. She needs something to slap her in the face, and this incident functions in this way in the novel. But Rita, of course, as I said before, is not so, let's say, open this discussion as Nora. Nora, of course, is in this brilliant story, of course, Nora is just more accomplished than her mother, even if she is 20-year-old. So you can say that, of course, this is just a tiny bit split for her. It's not just she all of a sudden realized everything, as I said before, the universal truth. But she seeks this incident. She tries to search herself. She tries to search for a, let's say, point to make her realize, to open her eyes. She does find it, eventually.
Okay, thank you. And I want to ask you a question to Yıldız. Your subject is something. It's not really familiar to me, but I was really interested in one of your sentences was quite striking for me, that was, we did what the others did. So, don't you think that every couple, father and mother, they also do what the others did, and also father and mother are their own other, in, also in that couple. What do you think about this? It's a general question, but I really wanted your opinion.
Actually, I couldn't get what you exactly...
I'm just asking a general question about that father-mother dichotomy and that binary position between those roles. What do you think about that? Don't you think that they are also their own others in that society, and each couple also their own others in that society? And there's a kind of dilemma in itself. What do you think about this?
Actually, as for me, yes, it is. But as far as I stated Morrison's thoughts, she mostly doesn't state father besides the child. She mostly doesn't get separate the mother from the child, but it's not the same situation with the father. So
in a way, do you also support this idea? I mean, okay, children get their mother and father, their role models. So, do you really think that they also get the inclination of that otherization in a way from their parents, because they are also others for themselves, or what?
If we think the mother and the child as a whole, mm-hmm. because she thinks that even after the birth, the mother and the child doesn't get separated. But in the father and the child, they're not together even before the birth.
So he is the other member, you say?
Yeah, that's it.
Okay. Thank you.
Yıldız, can we actually relate this to Freud's Oedipus complex?
Yes, I wanted to also mention Oedipus with Freud, but you know, it's really short time and land, so I didn't want to get involved.
I want to, well, maybe it's kind of a comment. Well, Anglo-American seems to be a very interesting novel.
Yes.
Well, the first thing that caught my attention was, the names, Nora and Yuta. Do you think that these are allusions? Because Nora reminds me of the character in A Doll's House by, you know.
Yes, you
that one,
perfect
and also
voice, yes.
There is another play, Educating Yuta.
Yes,
as
I read the novel at first time, I thought that might it be the maybe a replica of Nora, because of course she is in a cage, something like in a cage. Okay, she lives with her boyfriend or her husband. She can go away whenever she wants. But this is also a kind of a cage. Even if she realizes this, of course there is this truth. Or okay, we are women. We have some obligations to do. We have some paths to follow. But if you want to get out of it, and if you want to do it suddenly, in a flash of a moment, you will have some troubles with it, of course. With your family, with your surrounding, whatever the society is, how, let's say, modern the society is. I thought this Nora may be a representation, let's say, an illusion of that Nora in those us. And we listened a representation about it those us yesterday, and while I was listening to it, I thought that yes, there might be some connections between these.
I mean, they, in a way, I mean, Nora goes through the stages that
yes.
the Nora in A Doll's House goes.
Mm-hmm.
For example, you said Nora's not the little girl Richard is looking for.
Yes.
She's a woman.
Mm-hmm.
It's like Torvald is trying to find a little girl
yes,
instead
absolutely.
Of himself. But Nora grabs her bag and leaves the house. And also, Rita is a reference, I think, to Educating Rita. There is another play titled Educating Rita. If you haven't read it,
no, I haven't.
Read.
But if you just mention a bit, maybe you can find a connection between them. Because this Rita is a writer who sells a lot.
Well,
and that she has lots of novels.
Well,
yes.
This Rita leaves the school, starts a new life, but then, I mean, she's studying English language and literature, but she leaves her department and then she gets back to the school and she gets educated. In a way, you know, she knows everything, she gets into the male sphere.
Don't you think that this might be the afterlife of that Rita, maybe? If your Rita, let's say, if she followed a different path from that one, maybe she could end up like this.
might be, I mean, it might be a continuation, as you
know. Maybe, yes, maybe this can be parallel to that.
We don't know what happened to the Nora in Adolf's house, because she just gets her bag and leaves the house. What happens after that thing? Does she survive, or does she just fell out of the sky, just
like her? You can connect all these texts together. Maybe this is kind of a afterlife of the Rita. Okay, she got a good literary education, or she's a writer, or even though she's a light fiction writer, she does write eventually. But it's not like being a writer is just, okay, you're an artist, you are, let's say, all of a society, but no, you're not. This, my character is not, eventually.
So, I strongly believe, I mean, I just rely on this argumentation on your quotation from the book. This is a novel about the lost children,
yes.
Or child.
Lost children.
Lost children.
She says lost children,
so,
yes.
Nora was lost. Might
she
be
thinks
a continuation.
That. Maybe, but even if she's a writer, again, I'm repeating myself, she is unable to see such things. She thought that at the first time, when she found out that Nora was begging at the street, oh, my little baby, my baby daughter is lost. I lost her.
Yes, just like the Nora in the dollhouse, because her husband constantly calls her my, you
yes.
know, sunbird.
Yes, my duck, my bird.
Any animal
yes.
representation.
Mm-hmm, yes, she always says my baby daughter, my little girl, my little child, my baby,
yes.
etc., etc. She tries to get back her little daughter.
So
but no, she's not lost. Yes,
very
you touched upon a perfect point. Maybe we can connect these texts all together.
Yes. So educated Rita.
Educated Rita,
also.
Educated Rita and her afterlife maybe. Yes, why not?
Thank you.
I have a question for Betül. Betül, do you think Chaucer thinks beyond his age in terms of gender issues or just like another medieval person?
Actually there are studies about Chaucer's creating the court romance or the various texts that are written by a Boğaziçi or Nicomero. But as he is feminine, the current studies tradition is not really interested in him. They are more interested in the modern.
I have a question for you. This, to come back to Beloved and to your final claim about in this chain of women, we have a gap that is produced each time or handed down. And the question, the thing I remember about the novel is that there's this. Question that's repeated over and over: is this a story to be passed on?
Yeah.
Kind of paraphrasing. So on the one hand, is this gap nonverbal, or is it something? Because you also drew attention to this scene where, I mean, it's not. It's writing on the body. She says, "Look at this mark." So that's not so much nonverbal. How is this gap transmitted? Or
I have mentioned it's not something physical, of course, it's something mental. I have mentioned the gap which the children get when they are separated from their mother. Because when they lack motherly affection, they actually miss something and couldn't complete their self. So the gap is something which they cannot.
how much space they occupy in your brain. And for just 1 second video, you need 24 pictures. And big pictures. I mean, think about Blu-ray or HD. They occupy more space. Let's begin with the mental pollution. So mental pollution, if you want to give a definition about it, mental pollution is brains filling up with unnecessary information, unnecessary thoughts and visuals that you don't need to, but they are there. And there are three ways that we can be exposed to mental pollution. These are mass media, the internet, and subliminal messages. But since our subject is sexuality, the most dangerous mental pollution is the pollution that is caused by sexuality, because it causes fantasies and other thoughts in your brain. So it keeps your memory always busy and you cannot think of anything else. It also changes your bodily functions like high blood pressure, depression, and it can trigger your hormones. So it can hinder your learning. As we said, the most dangerous one is sexual content. Let's look at our ways. First, mass media. Mass media we call TV, magazines, and newspapers. When you think about it, there are so many sexual content on TV, magazines, and newspapers too. I will show you just two research about this in USA. First one is Brown. He stated that in 2001, 10% of TV programs and 20-30% of music videos include sexual intercourse. And it has been 11 years after that time, and it's gradually increasing every year. In another research, this guy found out that between these 20 years, the hour, what we call prime time, early evening, or family hour, it's the hour that family watch TV in USA. In these 20 years, they analyzed the content in TV, and they found out that sexual content was increasing, while the responsibility and the other messages, other positive messages, were getting lower and lower. And it has been 16 more years since then. Our next way is the internet that we use every day to reach information, to do our projects, to check weather forecast or anything. It is the miracle of our era, that's right, but it can be a ground that one can suicide himself. Because it is growing so fast that you cannot control it. Even the governments cannot control it. So there are so many sexual content in the internet too. And you are looking at a website, just a normal blog or any website. You see commercials, ads there, and they most probably are including sexual content. We'll see a very wide research in Australia among 16 and 17-year-old children. 84% of boys and 60% of girls are exposed to internet pornography by accidental. And 38% of these boys search for internet porn deliberately. And 4% of them search for it weekly. And when they are asked if this is common among the people that are the same age, they answered yes. 88% of boys think that sex searching on the internet is common, and 7% of girls think that sex searching is common. So what we understand from here is that with portable devices and the internet that is getting faster and faster every day, we are exposed to so much content. Not just sexual, but our subject is sexual, so we are exposed to so much sexual content that can hinder our learning. Our third way is subliminal messages. I think this is the most dangerous one, because subliminal messages are the messages that we cannot see them, but our subconscious brain, as I explained, perceives them. You don't even realize it. but it can change your behavior, it can change your thoughts and everything. Two techniques are used for subliminal messages, and first one is 25th picture, and the second one is hidden messages. Let's talk about 25th picture. 25th picture is, as I said before, you make 24 pictures for just 1 second video. What they do is, they put another picture, and they make it 25. It's just a small time, but you cannot see it, but your brain perceives all 25 of them. And you'll see an example here. The first use of 25th picture was in 1957 by James Picker. And in every 5 minutes, he put the messages of eat popcorn and drink coke in the movies. This is made in a movie theater. And after just 1 month, coke sales increased 57.5% and popcorn sales increased 18.1%. This is just amazing. And yeah. Second technique is hidden messages. These are the messages that are hidden in other pictures, videos, or writings, and anything. So we will see some examples here. Surely we have some smokers here, and here is a subliminal message on camel. As you can see here, there is a naked body on the picture of camel. And this can attract men easily. Really, you cannot see it if you don't look very carefully, but yeah, this is the fact. You can check it. And this is an old version of Pepsi, just a normal can, right? But when you put these two together, you can see the writing. And this cannot be a coincidence. These are made very deliberately. And look at this picture. These are just flowers, right? But there is a subliminal message there. Can anyone see it? Yeah, let's look at it like this. You'll see it better now. Yeah. And these subliminal messages are used in movies, even in cartoons, especially Disney. If you watch Disney, if you watch Little Mermaid or Lion King, there are a lot of subliminal messages. I couldn't put all of them here because they are even worse than this. And I'll show you just one example from Disney, Lion King. Simba comes here, he's very tired, and he lies down. And there's suddenly a dust cloud on the air, and it forms writing sex on the air, and it just goes away again. It happens very fast, but yeah. If you look very carefully, you can see it. And this is just one example. Please, yeah, this is my whole presentation, but please go and search for subliminal messages, search for the mental coalition. There are not so many research about this, but I think these are used for evil purposes generally, but this can be used for good also, but they don't want their secret to be revealed, I think, so there are not so many research about this. And mental polishing can hinder it. Not just your language learning, your learning of anything, because your brain is full. You cannot learn anything. So my request, my advice to my dear friends here is that please keep your brain free from mental polishing so that you can learn and improve yourself better.
Questions now, or do we have to wait for the session to come to an end?
I think we should let it wait for some time.
And in the explanation about Proverbs in the foreword, he says that a carefully selected listing of 2000 English and Turkish proverbs are included in the dictionary of 2006 to familiarize our students with similarities of traditional English and Turkish ways of thinking on various topics. These wise sayings, accompanied by their respective equivalents, not only express similarities of human thoughts between our cultures, but also provide ample means to learn vocabulary and grammatical structures of both English and Turkish languages. At this point, I want to examine how proverbs reflect gender roles, and also do the explanations of the gender-related proverbs in Turkish really express the cultural sentiment correctly in the original language, English. In the dictionary of 2007, there are many proverbs with gender-related meanings, and we know that in these proverbs, some of the superior terms are associated with masculinity, while the subordinate terms are associated with femininity. When we look at the proverbs, we can do groups according to the ones, which include female gender roles, relations of couples, male power on female during marriages, and negative characteristics of women. Firstly, I want to look at the proverbs of female gender roles. There are some proverbs which put emphasis on the female gender roles, and these are used commonly in both Turkish and English. When we look at the table, we see that an English proverb, a clever man will build a city, a clever woman will lay it down. In Turkish, it's explained like the way dişi kuş yapar. If you look at the explanation, there is an emphasis on the physical strength of men and the domestic role of women in private sphere, like self-sacrifice. In another example, marry your son when you will, your daughter when you can. This is explained as kızını fırsatınca oğlun isteyince evlendir. And the explanation can be done like this is to a woman to get married, and this is like the role of family on the marriage. Another example, the husband sings and the wife accompanies. Here, in Turkish, we say kadın erkeğin eşidir, evin neşidir. This is like taking the role of wife back after her husband. We see that all these proverbs are strengthening the stereotypical ideas of female gender roles. In another group, the proverbs of relations of couples. Here there are some negative ideas about women, as they are generally showing women the responsible for the problems in relations. When we look at the table again, in English, a crowing cock, a crowing hen, a whistling maid. Never bought a black to my house. This is explained as kadın hikmet diye umutlu olmaz. This is explained by the negative effect of dominant woman at home. A man's best fortune or his worst is a wife. Elinde karın güzelse, içinde iyiyse, bir işin var düğününde, bayramında. Bir oraya çık orada. Elinde karın çirkinse, içinde bozukse, ne işin var öyle evinde, gir aldı çık aldı. This probably explains the or historic effect of wife to their husbands. In another example, he that has wife and children wants no business. It explains as evlere hat olmayan dünya cehennemi. Here, the positive role of family in man's lives can be explained. And we see that here, the women are taught as having a lower status than their husbands in both English and Turkish. Another group, the proverbs of male power over the female. Here we see that in the proverbs, the lower status of woman is clearer, and this is made by the emphasis on the negative effect of the dominance of woman. We are looking at them again. A woman who talks like a man and a hen which crows like a cock are not good to anyone. Kadın hükmet diye bir kulak olmaz. The emphasis on the negative effect of the dominance of woman at home. Here we see very good effect of the absence of male at home, and here women are seen as slaves of male. Here we say that in both languages, women are shown as worse than men in terms of intelligence and ability. Last part are the proverbs of negative characteristics of women, and here the real emphasis is on the immoral tendencies of women and the need of women, the need of men to protect themselves from the woman. If you marry a beautiful woman, you marry a servant. This is explained in Turkish, güzellerle kavga orada. And the need to control beautiful and attractive wives are the explanation. A secret revealed to a woman is a bubble that is blown. This is explained in Turkish, arı sırrı, kır sırrı. And this is explained as the inability of women to keep secrets, like gossiping women. Another important example, women have long hair, have short brains, kalın kısmını saçın olur, az kısa. Here the emphasis is on the inability of women to think. As we see that there are many proverbs, including negative ideas about women. After that, we are looking at the translation process of the proverbs. The proverbs can also be examined about whether they could be explained correctly during translation into Turkish. While some of the explanations are suitable for the original English proverbs, it is seen that some of the Turkish proverbs are completely different from the English ones. The most important point is, while the words could be translated word by word, gender roles and social expectations of women are translated to a large extent according to the norms within the cultures. There are very similar gender-related roles in both languages, and the common usage of the proverbs are effective in strengthening this kind of codes within the culture. You see that there is no translation word by word in proverbs, but gender roles and social expectations of women are translated to a large extent. These are strengthening codes in the cultures. If you look at these examples, in English, a clever man will build the city, a clever woman will lay it down. This is translated in Turkish, yuva dişi kuş yapar. And while in English, the emphasis is on the cleverness of woman, in Turkish, the domestic role of woman is the meaning of the proverb. A man is old as he feels, and a woman is as old as she looks. Here, it is translated in Turkish, kadın var kardan soğuk, kadın var kordan sıcak. In English, the emphasis on the beauty of women, and in Turkish, the emphasis is on the differences of the attitudes of women. A fair wife, a lie dog, and a bad dog increase the make a rich man woman is translated into Turkish, kadın erkek değil, ardenans kurur. In English, the negative effect of immoral women to their husbands is the meaning of proverb, but in Turkish, the meaning is women are protected by the institute, not by men. We say that proverbs are the direct indicators of the ideas of people belonging to a culture, but it is difficult to explain the meanings of the proverbs in the dictionaries. There is big differences in the usage of frequency of proverbs in Turkish and English. However, generals are frequently seen in both proverbs of English and Turkish. There are some traditional and common generals in Turkish and language. English language and culture, and this is not directly translated each other. There is need to see the gender roles and how the society looks into the gender roles within the cultures. According to me, this is the first slide into this wide and important topic, as it can be examined by looking into other dictionaries and the reflections of attitudes towards gender roles in specific cultures. Thank you for listening.
Reminds me of Jung's collective unconscious.
unconscious theory. And as for Mehmet, I had lots of questions. It was a very confusing presentation indeed. You talked about sexuality quite in a quite negative way. You firstly gave the definition of mental pollution, and the explanation was not very clear, but quite vague. You related mental pollution only to sexual content of the things. So, what should people do in order to get away from mental pollution? Should they suppress their sexual desires, since you call sexuality dangerous? And you talk about sexuality and its enormous increase in our era. So what?
Okay, if you want to learn, like, there were some people that, in the past, when they read the page, they can just remember just by one time reading. And now we cannot do this because of, I mean, it's very hard to prevent from sexuality and mental pollution. I know that it is very hard, but we should lower the time that we watch TV, we surf from the internet.
So these are your advices, actually, because to me, we are living in a high-tech technology era, and we have computers. We don't need our memory to occupy lots of things to memorize stuff, right? So
yeah, but when you think about it, for example, for language learning, there are some DVDs and other things that, like, saying learn English in 10 days.
But there are lots of other things, not just sexuality. Your presentation, everything was sexualized, even the leaves, you know, the...
Yeah, because the subject is sexuality, that's what...
Yes,
I'm not saying just sexuality causes mental pollution. There are so many other things.
But it was presented that way. I know the title is gender and sexuality, so you pushed everything to be, you know, seen as sexualized. So it was, in a way, a little bit sensational for me. And it's called that there are normal sites, and I wonder what normal means to you.
Normal what?
Normal websites. I mean, normal blogs.
Oh, okay. You are just looking at a random blog, okay? But you see a pop-up or just an ad that is telling about sexual content, but you are not looking for that content. You are looking for the blog. But that advertisement comes into your mind. Maybe you don't even see it, but it occupies some space in your brain. That is pollution. I mean, that should be prevented. But there is no way that we can prevent it.
But you think that it should be prevented. Maybe I don't think that it should be prevented.
Yes.
Yeah, that's
right. So I mean, everybody, yes, you know, you have your own ideas and the way you present it was wrong. I mean, it shouldn't have been that way. Okay, these are my personal ideas. These, maybe it occupies your mind, but it doesn't occupy my mind, so it wasn't...
Yeah, I'm not saying don't look at sexual content. Of course, some people may have desires or some people may want to search about it.
Of course.
You can also, the best way to learn about sexual life, sexual health or anything is internet and mass media, of course.
The best way to learn language is to not to suppress your desires, but let them go, you know, go through a catharsis and get relaxed and then learn your language, not repress yourself. I have this sexual desire and I'm suppressing it, it occupies my mind. If you say this, of course it will, you know, occupy a huge, enormous, gigantic place in your mind. If you just let it go, then...
I'm not saying suppress all of it. Suppress just a little. That way you can learn better. I mean, there are some research about this, like students are given some certain videos, like violent sexual videos and other types of videos, and they are measured for their ability to learn vocabulary for language. And after those videos, they couldn't remember the words as much as the other ones that didn't watch the video. So I'm not saying suppress all of it, but if you watch like 3 hours of TV, just make it 2 hours, so you can know better. Just
okay.
Yes, please.
I agree to my friend. As far as I understand, you describe sexuality as a mental condition, not freedom of sexuality. Like, I see nothing wrong in those advertisement or something, okay. Because anything can occupy my mind.
Okay, I think I should make it clear just.
Yes, okay. Say that. Yeah, okay. It's not dangerous.
All sexuality is not mental pollution, but the most dangerous mental pollution is bisexual content. I'm not saying exclude all the sexual content from your life so you can live better. I'm not saying this. I'm just saying it can. I mean, you need these things, like the desires and, yeah, we are just normal human beings, but...
Do you think do you think that those advertisements can raise my sexuality more? I mean, I have all sexual desires. Do you think they will contribute to them?
Yes.
Seeing those kind
not as much as the real ones, but yeah, so this is true. I mean, there are not so many, but some research about also subliminal messages that when they include the sexual content, they can change the thoughts of a human. So, yeah.
First of all, I want to ask you, how do you define dangerous? And do you also advise us to put ourselves in a box so that we cannot see anything sexual or related to sexuality? Because in the example you gave, there was a package of a secret and there was a man on it. So are you also, not you, or let me say, do you think we are interacted with that man? So you think that we are also affected with the other things around us? I can see many men around, so there is no need to put that man on the secret.
But the man around you may not attract you to the secret. The man on the secret may attract you to the secret.
How?
But for example, a man is smoking, so he can easily attract me to
the secret. Yeah, I'm not saying that is wrong.
So it's
the same. That's pretty true.
Then
I'm not saying put yourselves in a box, okay? I'm just saying, okay, watch TV.
It's the same.
Okay, watch TV. Search on the websites like surf. But
what's the difference? From the man around and the one in the package. I want to learn that.
The difference is, okay, I'm saying the man may not attract you to the cigarette, but when you put that man on the cigarette, may attract you, maybe not you, but another woman. But this is just a theory, it's not proven, of course, but I'm just saying, okay, this is not that law. This is just a theory, of course. And I'm not saying put yourselves in a box. Just try to lower it and try to prevent from unnecessary TV, unnecessary websites, unnecessary surfing. I mean, when you have a free time, just go read a book. Don't surf on the internet.
Okay, and my first question, how do you define dangerous?
Dangerous is the... Okay, most effective, I would say.
Okay, and short advice to you, if you didn't watch it, I advise you to watch Eyes Wide Shut by Kubrick, so you can have a wide perspective about this subject.
The movie that says the man puts a glass in.
No, not glass, he puts a mask.
Oh, movie.
It's called
I Advise You to Watch.
Okay, I advise you to
watch. Yes, I have a question for you and for you and I will be able to do. You talked about light translation, right? Light translation. And I'm wondering if direct translation is possible without the effects of culture.
I'm arguing that direct translation is not possible without translating the cultural norms. In this study, I have just kept one example of translation in just one dictionary. And
writer of the dictionary just translated all these proverbs is the same, is the way I think is problem. And I don't think that direct translation is possible in proverbs.
And also you put the title to your presentation, correct translation. And I'm wondering if there's a correct translation, if there's always a cultural effect on the translation.
Yeah, I agree that it's not possible. It's just possible by being inside of the culture. And understanding real meaning of some kind of language structures like proverbs, because these are very, very bound to the cultural norms. Learning the real meanings of this is just possible by being or living in a culture in a some time. This is just not possible by this.
And
to
come to your question, you actually, if you put the good sides of subliminal messages to your presentation, it will be more clear. Because I'm taking copywriting certificate for advertisement companies or the other ones. And we are studying on subliminal messages and to affect the customers, how advertisements affect customers. And the use of sexual messages to attract our customers so that our product can have effect on them and they bought those products, I can say. So if you put those type of things on your presentation, it will be more clear for other people. So, because you always focus on one side of those subliminal messages,
I mean,
okay, think about those good sides.
Yeah, there are also good sides. Like, they are used in commercials to sell the goods. Like, you see every time, bu programda sana bir reklam uygulaması yapın. That is actually, like, that may include subliminal messages. But since the time is short, I couldn't write everything here. That's why, but there are also good sides. Yeah, they can be used for good also. Yeah, you're right.
And I can give an example for those kinds of messages, those kinds of advertisements. In one of the advertisements, the sexual scene that we see in film is described by describing vegetables and fruits. You cannot imagine how it affects the customers. I don't know if you know those advertisements, but you can do it in some kind of lots of them, and you can and they put shapes in such a way that they put fruits or vegetables in such a way that you can obviously see the underwear of women or men in those advertisements, but of course it's not possible for everyone to see.
As I said, go and search for it. This is just a small percentage of both mental pollution and sexual content. Just
it will be better because it's the average to.
Yes,
please. I'm not asking a question. I just want to make a comment on Sinem's presentation. It was a very good presentation, actually. I'd like to thank you first. While I was listening to your presentation, it reminded me the theory of Derrida. As he says, we do not speak language, but language speaks us. And it means that we cannot go out of the discourse, and it speaks us. It gives all the cultural norms to us, conveys to us via language. And your presentation is a very good representative of this theory.
Thank you. I'd like to thank you both for the presentations. My first remark and question will go to you, Mehmet. I think what you were trying to say was a very good thing on subliminal messages, in that the fact that you were trying to raise some awareness, I guess, because these dangerous contents you're referring to, I think you were mentioning about the little ones, not grown-ups like us who know what those messages may mean, but the ones, you know, 5 or 6 years old on the internet is everywhere now. But they are, you know, able to see the, you know, the BDSM videos on the internet, and they go and ask their mothers, you know, what this violence is, and they can't explain this. So it may be a good idea to filter the internet for the use of children, for example, but I have to agree with my friend on the subject that sexual desire on the internet is not a dangerous thing. But I agree with you on the subject too that if it's not our willing to see that, I don't have to, and that therefore they shouldn't be on the internet, as you said, you know, not like the pop-ups.
That's what I was saying.
Yeah, like viruses going on my Internet Explorer. I don't want to see a naked lady every time. But you know, if I want to see one, then I should be able to do so.
That's
why I understand you on that point. But what concerned me was at the very end of your presentation, you said they who want to harm us. Who are you referring to by that they? Who is this, you know, community that wants to harm us so badly? This ideology.
Okay, like I said, Disney. They used so many stereotypes in their cartoons and these messages. I think, this is my personal opinion, you may search about it, but they use so many stereotypes. Like, to give an example, did you watch Pepe the Lover? Yeah, right? But he speaks with that French accent.
Yeah.
Why? Because it's a stereotype, right?
Yeah,
but like that, also, they use sexual content like subliminal messages so that they can put some messages into the society's brains.
Of course, I agree on that. Disney is using these stereotypes too.
Yeah.
In the very fact, even in my presentation, I used Disney's Little Mermaid to show, you know, the fact that little girls are very affected by those movies. But you know, it's an inevitable fact for our children to see them, so we can't protect them, you know, from that messages. What's important is that we should raise the awareness of it. We should tell our girl, you know, that just because a girl is giving up her voice to marry someone, don't do that. So I wanted to clarify on that point. And with you, yours was a very nice presentation too. I was very impressed. But I was wondering, all these proverbs were actually cons to women's rights. But are there any positive ones? You know, because not now in our culture, but in the very old Turkish culture, women was very equal with the men, and they were also, you know, not queens, but you know, in very ancient Turkish tribes, the women had also power. I'm wondering, since that time, do we have a proverb that we inherit from those times? You know,
yes.
Metaphorically, the women's
some
power.
Positive proverbs about women in general. In this dictionary,
that specific dictionary.
The writer always giving things in this way. There are some positive examples also in this dictionary. However, the hyper symptom are negative. So I want to focus on the dictionary.
Okay. Thank you.
Unfortunately, we've reached out of our time, so it's high time to finish this session. Okay. Disney's or Pepsi's purpose is when they pollute our minds with these sexual contents. Just your opinion.
Actually, I'm wondering the same thing because they are trying to, like, it's a fact that these messages corrupt our society, like stereotypes. When you watch that cartoon, you are also accepting that stereotype. So I don't know why they are doing this, but they are trying to impose some